This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Theodor Seuss Geisel, SS, I, ˈsɔɪs, March 2, 1904. 1958 for Horton hatches the egg and again in 1961 for And to Think That I Saw It on Mulberry Street. Geisel's birthday, March 2, has been adopted as the annual date for National Read Across America Day, an initiative on reading created by the National Education Association. Contents 1 Life and Career 11 Early Years 12 Early Career 13 ˈsɔɪmarine 14 World War II Era Work 15 Later Years 2 Illness, Death, and Posthumous Honors 3 Pen Names and Pronunciations 4 Political Views 41 in his books 5 Poetic Meters 6 Artwork 61 Recurring Images 7 Publications 8 Films based on his books 9 Adaptations 91 Music 10 See also 11 References 12 Further Reading 13 External Links Life and Career Early Years Geisel was born and raised in Springfield, Massachusetts, the son of Henrietta née Seuss and Theodor Robert Geisel. All 4 of his grandparents were German immigrants. His father managed the family brewery and was later appointed to supervise Springfield's public park system by Mayor John A. Dennison after the brewery closed because of Prohibition. Mulberry Street in Springfield, made famous in Dr. Seuss's first children's book And to Think That I Saw It on Mulberry Street, is less than a mile southwest of his boyhood home on Fairfield Street. Geisel was raised a Lutheran. He enrolled at Springfield Central High School in 1917 and graduated in 1921. He took an art class as a freshman and later became manager of the school soccer team. Geisel attended Dartmouth College, graduating in 1925 at Dartmouth. He joined the Sigma Phi Epsilon fraternity and the humor magazine Dartmouth Jack-o'-Lantern, eventually rising to the rank of editor-in-chief while at Dartmouth. He was caught drinking gin with 9 friends in his room at the time. The possession and consumption of alcohol was illegal under prohibition laws, which remained in place between 1920 and 1933 as a result of this infraction. Dean Craven Laycock insisted that Geisel resign from all extracurricular activities, including the college humor magazine, to continue work on the Jack-o'-Lantern without the administration's knowledge. Geisel began signing his work with the pen name Seuss. He was encouraged in his writing by Professor of Rhetoric W. Benfield Pressey, whom he described as his big inspiration for writing at Dartmouth. Upon graduating from Dartmouth, he entered Lincoln College, Oxford, intending to earn a Ph.D. in English Literature at Oxford. He met Helen Palmer, who encouraged him to give up becoming an English teacher in favor of pursuing drawing as a career. Early career. Geisel left Oxford without earning a degree and returned to the United States in February 1927, where he immediately began submitting writings and drawings to magazines, book publishers, and advertising agencies. Making use of his time in Europe, he pitched a series of cartoons called Eminent Europeans to Life magazine, but the magazine passed on it. His first nationally published cartoon appeared in the July 16, 1927 issue of the Saturday Evening Post. This single $25 sale encouraged Geisel to move from Springfield to New York City. Later that year, Geisel accepted a job as writer and illustrator at the humor magazine Judge, and he felt financially stable enough to marry Helen. His first cartoon for Judge appeared on October 22, 1927, and the Geisels were married on November 29. Geisel's first work, signed Dr. Seuss, was published in Judge about 6 months after he started working there in early 1928. One of Geisel's cartoons for Judge mentioned Flit, a common bug spray at the time manufactured by Standard Oil of New Jersey. According to Geisel, the wife of an advertising executive in charge of advertising, Flit saw Geisel's cartoon at a hairdresser's and urged her husband to sign him. Geisel's first Flit ad appeared on May 31, 1928, and the campaign continued sporadically until 1941. The campaign's catchphrase, "Quick, Henry, the Flit," became a part of popular culture. It spawned a song and was used as a punch line for comedians such as Fred Allen and Jack Benny. As Geisel gained notoriety for the Flit campaign, his work was sought after and began to appear regularly in magazines such as Life, Liberty, and Vanity Fair. Geisel supported himself and his wife through the Great Depression by drawing advertising for General Electric, NBC, Standard Oil, Narragansett Brewing Company, and many other companies. In 1935, he wrote and drew a short-lived comic strip called Hedgie. The increased income allowed the Geisels to move to better quarters and to socialize in higher social circles. They became friends with the wealthy family of banker Frank A. Vanderlip. They also traveled extensively. By 1936, Geisel and his wife had visited 30 countries together. They did not have children, neither kept regular office hours, and they had ample money. Geisel also felt that the traveling helped his creativity. In 1936, the couple were returning from an ocean voyage to Europe when the rhythm of the ship's engines inspired the poem that became his first book, and to think that I saw it on Mulberry Street. Based on Geisel's varied accounts, the book was rejected by between 20 and 43 publishers. According to Geisel, he was walking home to burn the manuscript when a chance encounter with an old Dartmouth classmate led to its publication by Vanguard Press. Geisel wrote four more books before the U.S. entered World War II. This included The 500 Hats of Bartholomew Cubbins in 1938, as well as The King's Stilts and The Seven Lady Godivas in 1939, all of which were in prose. Atypically for him, this was followed by Horton Hatch's The Egg in 1940, in which Geisel returned to the use of poetry. Esomarine Geisel gained a significant public profile through a program for motor boat lubricants produced by Standard Oil under the brand name Esomarine. He later recounted that Harry Bruno, Ted Cook, and Vern Carrier worked with him at the National Motor Boat Show on exhibits referred to as the suːs Navy in 1934. Geisel produced a 30-page booklet entitled Secrets of the Deep, which was available by mail after June at the January Boat Show for 1935. Visitors filled out order cards to receive secrets. Geisel drew up a certificate of commission for visitors in 1936. A mock ship deck called SS Esomarine provided the scene where photos of admirals were taken that summer. Geisel released a second volume of Secrets for the 1937 show. He sculpted marine mugs and designed a flag for the suːs Navy. The following year featured Little Dramas of the Deep, a six-act play with 10 characters. According to Geisel's sister, he plans the whole show with scenery and action, and then, standing in a realistic bridge, reels off a speech which combines advertising with humor. For 1939, exhibitors made available the Nuzzlepuss ashtray and illustrated tide table calendars. A suːs Navy luncheon was held on January 11, 1940 at the Waldorf Astoria Hotel at that year's boat show. Geisel provided the Navigamarama exhibit and the Sea Lawyer's Gazette. The final contribution to the Esomarine project was the mermaid Essie Neptune and her pet whale in 1941. The exhibit offered photos for a happy cruising passport World War II era work play media. The Gold Brick, Private Snafu episode written by Geisel, 1943. As World War II began, Geisel turned to political cartoons, drawing over 400 in 2 years as editorial cartoonist for the left-leaning New York City daily newspaper. P.M. Geisel's political cartoons, later published in Dr. Seuss Goes to War, denounced Hitler and Mussolini and were highly critical of non-interventionists, isolationists, most notably Charles Lindbergh, who opposed U.S. entry into the war. One cartoon depicted all Japanese Americans as latent traitors or fifth columnists, while other cartoons simultaneously deplored the racism at home against Jews and blacks that harmed the war effort. His cartoons were strongly supportive of President Roosevelt's handling of the war, combining the usual exhortations to ration and contribute to the war effort with frequent attacks on Congress, especially the Republican Party. Parts of the press, such as the New York Daily News, Chicago Tribune, and Washington Times Herald, and others for criticism of Roosevelt, criticism of aid to the Soviet Union, investigation of suspected communists, and other offenses that he depicted as leading to disunity and helping the Nazis, intentionally or inadvertently. In 1942, Geisel turned his energies to direct support of the U.S. war effort. First, he worked drawing posters for the Treasury Department and the War Production Board. Then, in 1943, he joined the Army as a captain and was commander of the Animation Department of the 1st Motion Picture Unit of the United States Army Air Forces, where he wrote films that included Your Job. In Germany, a 1945 propaganda film about peace in Europe after World War II, Our Job in Japan, and the Private Snafu series of adult army training films. While in the army, he was awarded the Legion of Merit. Our Job in Japan became the basis for the commercially released film Design for Death 1947, a study of Japanese culture that won the Academy Award for documentary feature. Gerald McBoeing Boeing 1950 was based on an original story by Seuss and won the Academy Award for animated animated short film later years after the war, Geisel and his wife moved to La Jolla, California, where he returned to writing children's books. He wrote many, including such favorites as If I Ran the Zoo 1950, Horton Hears a Who 1955, If I Ran the Circus 1956, The Cat in the Hat 1957, How the Grinch Stole Christmas 1957, and Green Eggs and Ham 1960. He received numerous awards throughout his career, but he won neither the Caldecott Medal nor the Newbery Medal. Three of his titles from this period were, however, chosen as Caldecott runners-up, now referred to as Caldecott Honor Books: McKelliga's Pool 1947, Bartholomew and the Oobleck 1949, and If I Ran the Zoo 1950. Dr. Seuss also wrote the musical and fantasy film The 5,000 Fingers of Dr. T, which was released in 1953. The movie was a critical and financial failure, and Geisel never attempted another feature film during the 1950s. He also published a number of illustrated short stories, mostly in Redbook magazine. Some of these were later collected in volumes such as The Sneetches and Other Stories are reworked into independent books. If I Ran the Zoo, a number have never been reprinted since their original appearances in May 1954. Life magazine published a report on illiteracy among school children, which concluded that children were not learning to read because their books were boring. William Ellsworth Spalding was the director of the education division at Houghton Mifflin. He later became its chairman, and he compiled a list of 348 words that he felt were important for first graders to recognize. He asked Geisel to cut the list to 250 words and to write a book using only those words. Spalding challenged Geisel to bring back a book children can't put down. 9 months later, Geisel completed The Cat in the Hat, using 236 of the words given to him. It retained the drawing style, verse rhythms, and all the imaginative power of Geisel's earlier works, but, because of its simplified vocabulary, it could be read by beginning readers. The Cat in the Hat and subsequent books written for young children achieved significant international success, and they remain very popular today. In 2009, Green Eggs and Ham sold 540,366 copies, The Cat in the Hat sold 452,258 copies, and One Fish, Two Fish, Red Fish, Blue Fish 1960 sold 409,068 copies, outselling the majority of newly published children's books. Geisel went on to write many other children's books, both in his new simplified vocabulary manner sold as beginner books and in his older, more elaborate style. In 1956, Dartmouth awarded Geisel with an honorary doctorate, finally justifying the doctor in his pen name. On April 28, 1958, Geisel appeared on an episode of the panel game show To Tell the Truth. Geisel's wife Helen Palmer Geisel had a long struggle with illnesses, including cancer and emotional pain over her husband's affair with Audrey Stone Diamond. On October 23, 1967, she committed suicide. Geisel married Diamond on June 21, 1968. Geisel had no children of his own, though he devoted most of his life to writing children's books. He would say when asked about this, "You have 'em, I'll entertain 'em." Geisel received the Laura Ingalls Wilder Medal from the Professional Children's Librarians in 1980, recognizing his substantial and lasting contributions to children's literature. At the time, it was awarded every 5 years. He won a special Pulitzer Prize in 1984, citing his contribution over nearly half a century to the education and enjoyment of America's children and their parents' illness, death, and posthumous honors. Geisel died of oral cancer on September 24, 1991 at his home in La Jolla at the age of 87. He was cremated and his ashes were scattered on December 1, 1995, 4 years after his death. University of California, San Diego's University Library Building was renamed Geisel Library in honor of Geisel and Audrey for the generous contributions that they made to the library and their devotion to improving literacy while Geisel was living in La Jolla. The United States Postal Service and others frequently confused him with fellow La Jolla resident Dr. Hans Seuss. Their names have been linked together posthumously. The personal papers of Hans Seuss are housed in the Geisel Library. In 2002, the Dr. Seuss National Memorial Sculpture Garden opened in his birthplace of Springfield, Massachusetts, featuring sculptures of Geisel and of many of his characters. On May 28, 2008, California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger and First Lady Maria Shriver announced that Geisel would be inducted into the California Hall of Fame, located at the California Museum for History, Women and the Arts. The induction ceremony took place December 15, and Geisel's widow Audrey accepted the honor in his place on March 2, 2009. The web search engine Google temporarily changed its logo to commemorate Geisel's birthday, a practice that it often follows for various holidays. holidays and events in 2004, U.S. Children's Librarians established the annual Theodor Seuss Geisel Award to recognize the most distinguished American book for beginning readers published in English in the United States during the preceding year. It should demonstrate creativity and imagination to engage children in reading during years pre-K to grade 2 at Geisel's alma mater of Dartmouth, more than 90% of incoming first-year students. Participate in pre-registration Dartmouth Outing Club trips into the New Hampshire wilderness. It is traditional for students returning from the trips to stay overnight at Dartmouth's Moosilauke Ravine Lodge, where they are served green eggs and ham for breakfast in honor of Dr. Seuss on April 4, 2012. The Dartmouth Medical School renamed itself the Audrey and Theodor Geisel School of Medicine in honor of their many years of generosity to the college. Dr. Seuss's honors include 2 Academy Awards, 2 Emmy Awards, a Peabody Award, the Laura Ingalls Wilder Medal, and the Pulitzer Prize. Dr. Seuss has a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame at the 6500 block of Hollywood Boulevard. Pen names and pronunciations. Geisel's most famous pen name is regularly pronounced Sjus, an anglicized pronunciation inconsistent with his German surname. The standard German pronunciation is, he himself noted that it rhymed with voice, his own pronunciation being SS. Alexander Lawing, one of his collaborators on the Dartmouth Jack-o'-Lantern, wrote of it, "You're wrong as the deuce, and you shouldn't rejoice if you're calling him Seuss. He pronounces it ˈsɔɪs or ˈsɔɪs." Geisel switched to the anglicized pronunciation because it evoked a figure advantageous for an author of children's books to be associated with, Mother Goose, and because most people use this pronunciation. He added the doctor to his pen name because his father had always wanted him to practice medicine. For books that Geisel wrote and others illustrated, he used the pen name Theo Lessig, starting with I Wish That I Had Duck Feet, published in 1965. Lessig is Geisel spelled backward. Geisel also published one book under the name Rosetta Stone, 1975's Because a Little Bug Went Ka-Choo, a collaboration with Michael K. Frith. Frith and Geisel chose the name in honor of Geisel's second wife Audrey, whose maiden name was Stone. Political Views main article. Political messages of Dr. Seuss. Geisel was a liberal Democrat and a supporter of President Franklin D. Roosevelt and the New Deal. His early political cartoons show a passionate opposition to fascism, and he urged action against it both before and after the United States entered World War II. His cartoons portrayed the fear of communism as overstated, finding greater threats in the House Un-American Activities Committee and those who threatened to cut the U.S. lifeline to Stalin and the USSR, whom he once depicted as a porter carrying our war load. Geisel supported the Japanese-American internment during World War II. His treatment of the Japanese and of Japanese-Americans between whom he often failed to differentiate has struck many readers as a moral blind spot on the issue of the Japanese. He is quoted as saying, "But right now, when the Japs are planting their hatchets in our skulls, it seems like a hell of a time for us to smile and warble, brothers. It is a rather flabby battle cry if we want to win. We've got to kill Japs, whether it depresses John Haynes Holmes or not. We can get palsy-walsy afterward with those that are left after the war." Though, Geisel overcame his feelings of animosity, using his book Horton Hears a Who, 1954 as an allegory for the Hiroshima bombing and the American post-war occupation of Japan, as well as dedicating the book to a Japanese friend in 1948. After living and working in Hollywood for years, Geisel moved to La Jolla, California, a predominantly Republican town. Geisel converted a copy of one of his famous children's books into a polemic shortly before the end of the 1972-74 Watergate scandal, in which United States President Richard Nixon resigned, by replacing the name of the main character everywhere that it occurred. Richard M. Nixon, Will You Please Go Now, was published in major newspapers through the column of his friend Art Buchwald. The line, "A person's a person, no matter how small," from Horton Hears a Who, has been used widely as a slogan by the pro-life movement in the U.S. Despite the objections of Geisel's widow, the line was first used in such a way in 1986, he demanded a retraction and received one in his books. Geisel made a point of not beginning to write his stories with a moral in mind, stating that "kids can see a moral coming a mile off." He was not against writing about issues, however, he said that "there's an inherent moral in any story," and he remarked that he was "subversive as hell." Many of Geisel's books express his views on a remarkable variety of social and political issues: The Lorax, 1971, about environmentalism and anti-consumerism; The Sneetches, 1961, about racial equality; The Butter Battle Book, 1984, about the arms race; Yertle the Turtle, 1958, about Hitler and anti-authoritarianism; How the Grinch Stole Christmas, 1957, criticizing the materialism and consumerism of the Christmas season; and Horton Hears a Who. 1954, about anti-isolationism and internationalism. Poetic meters. Geisel wrote most of his books in anapestic tetrameter, a poetic meter employed by many poets of the English literary canon. This is often suggested as one of the reasons that Geisel's writing was so well received. Anapestic tetrameter consists of four rhythmic units called anapists, each composed of two weak syllables followed by one strong syllable. The beat, often, the first weak syllable is omitted, or an additional weak syllable is added at the end. An example of this meter can be found in Geisel's Yertl the Turtle, from Yertl the Turtle and Other Stories, and Today the Great Yertl, That Marvelous He Is King of the Mud. That is all he can see. Some books by Geisel that are written mainly in anapestic tetrameter also contain many lines written in amphibrachic tetrameter, such as these from If I Ran the Circus, All Ready to Put Up the Tents for My Circus, I Think I Will Call It the Circus McGurkus, and Now Comes an Act of Enormous Enormance. No former performers performed this performance. Geisel also wrote verse in trochaic tetrameter, an arrangement of a strong syllable followed by a weak syllable, with four units per line. For example, the title of One Fish, Two Fish, Red Fish, Blue Fish. Traditionally, English trochaic meter permits the final weak position in the line to be omitted, which allows both masculine and feminine rhymes. Geisel generally maintained trochaic meter for only brief passages, and for longer stretches typically mixed it with iambic tetrameter, which consists of a weak syllable followed by a strong, and is generally considered easier to write thus. For example, the magicians in Bartholomew and the Ubleck make their first appearance chanting in troches, thus resembling the witches of Shakespeare's Macbeth. Shuffle, duffle, muzzle, muff. They then switch to iambs for the Ubleck spell, go make the Ubleck tumble down on every street, in every town. Artwork. Geisel at work on a drawing of the Grinch for How the Grinch Stole Christmas. In 1957, Geisel's early artwork often employed the shaded texture of pencil drawings or watercolors, but in his children's books of the post-war period, he generally made use of a starker medium, pen and ink, normally using just black, white, and one or two colors. His later books, such as The Lorax, used more colors. Geisel's style was unique. His figures are often rounded and somewhat droopy. This is true, for instance, of the faces of the Grinch and the Cat in the Hat. Almost all his buildings and machinery were devoid of straight lines when they were drawn, even when he was representing real objects. For example, If I Ran the Circus shows a droopy hoisting crane and a droopy steam calliope. Geisel evidently enjoyed drawing architecturally elaborate objects. His endlessly varied but never rectilinear palaces, ramps, platforms, and freestanding stairways are among his most evocative creations. Geisel also drew complex imaginary machines, such as the Audio Tally O Count, from Dr. Seuss's Sleep Book, or the Most Peculiar Machine of Sylvester McMonkey McBean in The Sneetches. Geisel also liked drawing outlandish arrangements of feathers or fur, for example, the 500th hat of Bartholomew Cubbins, the tail of Gertrude McFuzz, and the pet for girls who like to brush and comb. In One Fish, Two Fish, Geisel's illustrations often convey motion vividly. He was fond of a sort of voila gesture in which the hand flips outward and the fingers spread slightly backward with the thumb up. This motion is done by ˈsɔɪs in One Fish, Two Fish, when he creates fish who perform the gesture themselves with their fins. In the introduction of the various acts of If I Ran the Circus, and in the introduction of the Little Cats in The Cat in the Hat Comes Back, he was also fond of drawing hands with interlocked fingers, making it look as though his characters were twiddling their thumbs. Geisel also follows the cartoon tradition of showing motion with lines, like in the sweeping lines that accompany Sneelock's final dive in If I Ran the Circus. Cartoon lines are also used to illustrate the action of the senses, sight, smell, and hearing, in The Big Brag, and lines even illustrate thought, as in the moment when the Grinch conceives his awful plan to ruin Christmas. Recurring images. Geisel's early work in advertising and editorial cartooning helped him to produce sketches of things that received more perfect realization later in his children's books. Often, the expressive use to which Geisel put an image later on was quite different from the original. Here are some examples. An editorial cartoon from July 16, 1941. Depicts a whale resting on the top of a mountain as a parody of American isolationists, especially Charles Lindbergh. This was later rendered with no apparent political content as the Wombus of On Beyond Zebra. 1955 Susian whales, cheerful and balloon-shaped, with long eyelashes, also occur in McKellaga's Pool, If I Ran the Circus, and other books. Another editorial cartoon from 1941 shows a long cow with many legs and udders representing the conquered nations of Europe being milked by Adolf Hitler. This later became the Umbus of On Beyond Zebra. The Tower of Turtles in a 1942 editorial cartoon prefigures a similar tower in Yertl the Turtle. This theme also appeared in a Judge cartoon as one letter of a hieroglyphic message. and in Geisel's short-lived comic strip Hedgie Geisel once stated that Yertle the Turtle was Adolf Hitler Little Cats A, B, and C as well as the rest of the alphabet who spring from each other's hats appeared in a Ford ad The Connected Beards in Did I Ever Tell You How Lucky You Are appear frequently in Geisel's work, most notably in Hedgie, which featured two goats joined at the beard, The 5,000 Fingers of Dr. T, which featured two roller skating guards joined at the beard, and a political cartoon in which Nazism and the America First Movement are portrayed as the men with the Siamese beard. Geisel's earliest elephants were for advertising and had somewhat wrinkly ears, much as real elephants do with and to think that I saw it on Mulberry Street. 1937 and Horton hatches the egg 1940, the ears became more stylized, somewhat like angel wings and thus appropriate to the saintly Horton during World War II. The elephant image appeared as an emblem for India in four editorial cartoons. Horton and similar elephants appear frequently in the post-war children's books while drawing advertisements for Flit. Geisel became adept at drawing insects with huge stingers, shaped like a gentle S-curve and with a sharp end that included a rearward pointing barb on its lower side. Their facial expressions depict gleeful malevolence. These insects were later rendered in an editorial cartoon as a swarm of Allied aircraft 1942, and again as the Sneedle of On Beyond Zebra, and yet again as the Skrits and I Had Trouble in Getting to Sola Salu. There are many examples of creatures who arrange themselves in repeating patterns, such as the to and fro walkers, who march in five layers, and the through horns jumping deer in If I Ran the Circus, and the arrangement of birds which the protagonist of Oh, the Places You'll Go, walks through, as the narrator admonishes him to. For Diffendoofer Day, and Daisy Head Maisie My Many Colored Days was originally written in 1973 but was posthumously published in 1996. In September 2011, seven stories originally published in magazines during the 1950s were released in a collection entitled The Bipolo Seed and Other Lost Stories. Geisel also wrote a pair of books for adults, The Seven Lady Godivas 1939, reprinted 1987, a retelling of the Lady Godiva legend that included nude depictions, and You're Only Old Once. Written in 1986 when Geisel was 82, which chronicles an old man's journey through a clinic. His last book was Oh, the Places You'll Go, which published the year before his death and became a popular gift for graduating students. Films based on his books year film directed by written by distributor budget gross 2000. How the Grinch Stole Christmas Ron Howard Jeffrey Price and Peter S. Seaman Universal Pictures $123 million $345,141,403 2003 The Cat in the Hat Beau Welch Alec Berg, David Mandel and Jeff Schaefer Universal Pictures and DreamWorks Pictures $109 million $133,960,541 2008 Horton Hears a Who, Jimmy Hayward and Steve Martino Ken Dorio and Cinco Paul 20th Century Fox. $85 million $297,138,014 2012 The Lorax Chris Renault and Kyle Balda Universal Pictures $70 million $348,840,316 Adaptation Seuss Landing at Islands of Adventure in Orlando For most of his career, Geisel was reluctant to have his characters marketed in contexts outside of his own books. However, he did permit the creation of several animated cartoons, an art form in which he himself had gained experience during the Second World War, and he gradually relaxed his policy as he aged. The first adaptation of one of Geisel's works was a cartoon version of Horton Hatches the Egg, animated at Warner Brothers in 1942 and directed by Robert Clampett. It was presented as part of the Merry Melodies series and included a number of gags not present in the original narrative, including a fish committing suicide and a Katharine Hepburn imitation by Maisie. In 1959, Geisel authorized Ray Vail, the well-known plastic model-making company, to make a series of animals that snapped together rather than being glued together, and could be assembled, disassembled, and reassembled in thousands of ways. The series was called the Dr. Seuss Zoo and included Gaudy the Dowdy Grackle, Norval the Bashful Blinket, Tingo the Noodle-Topped Strudel, and Roscoe the Many-Footed Lion. The basic body parts were the same and all were interchangeable, and so it was possible for children to combine parts from various characters in essentially unlimited ways in creating their own animal characters. Ray Vail encouraged this by selling Gaudy, Norval, and Tingo together in a gift set as well as individually. Ray Vail also made a conventional glue together beginner's kit of the Cat in the Hat in 1966. Geisel authorized eminent cartoon artist Chuck Jones, his friend and former colleague from the war, to make a cartoon version of How the Grinch Stole Christmas. Geisel was credited as a co-producer under his real name Ted Geisel. Along with Jones, the cartoon was narrated by Boris Karloff, who also provided the voice of the Grinch. It was very faithful to the original book, and is considered a classic to this day by many. It is often broadcast as an annual Christmas television special. Jones directed an adaptation of Horton Hears a Who, in 1970, and produced an adaptation of The Cat in the Hat in 1971. From 1972 to 1983, Geisel wrote 6 animated specials which were produced by De Patty Freleng, The Lorax 1972, Dr. Seuss on the Loose 1973, The Huber Bloob Highway 1975, Halloween as Grinch Night 1977, Pontoffel Pock, Where Are You 1980, and The Grinch Grinches the Cat in the Hat 1982. Several of the specials won multiple Emmy Awards. A Soviet paint-on-glass animated short film was made in 1986 called Welcome, an adaptation of Thidwick the Big-Hearted Moose. The last adaptation of Geisel's work before he died was The Butter Battle Book, a television special based on the book of the same name, directed by adult animation legend Ralph Bakshi. A television film titled In Search of Dr. Seuss was released in 1994, which adapted many of Seuss's stories. It uses both live-action versions and animated versions of the characters and stories featured. However, the animated portions were merely edited versions of previous animated television specials and, in some cases, redubbed as well. After Geisel died of cancer at the age of 87 in 1991. His widow Audrey Geisel was placed in charge of all licensing matters. She approved a live-action feature film version of How the Grinch Stole Christmas starring Jim Carrey, as well as a Seuss-themed Broadway musical called Seussical, and both premiered in 2000. The Grinch has had limited engagement runs on Broadway during the Christmas season. After premiering in 1998 under the title How the Grinch Stole Christmas at the Old Globe Theater in San Diego, where it has become a Christmas tradition, in 2003, another live-action film was released, this time an adaptation of The Cat in the Hat that featured Mike Myers as the title character. Audrey Geisel has spoken critically of the film, especially the casting of Myers as the Cat in the Hat, and stated that she would not allow any further live-action adaptations of Geisel's books. However, an animated CGI feature film adaptation of Horton Hears a Who was approved, and was eventually released on March 14, 2008. To critical acclaim, a CGI animated feature film adaptation of The Lorax was released by Universal on March 2, 2012, on what would have been the 108th birthday of Seuss. 4 television series have been adapted from Geisel's work. The first, Gerald McBoing Boing, was an animated television adaptation of Geisel's 1951 cartoon of the same name and lasted 3 months between 1956 and 1957. The second, The Wubulous World of Dr. Seuss, was a mix of live action and puppetry by Jim Henson Television, the producers of The Muppets. It aired for 1 season on Nickelodeon in the United States, from 1996 to 1997. The third, Gerald McBoing Boing, is a remake of the 1956 series produced in Canada by Cookie Jar Entertainment, now DHX Media, and North America by Classic Media, now DreamWorks Classics. It ran from 2005 to 2007. The fourth, The Cat in the Hat Knows a Lot About That, produced by Portfolio Entertainment Inc., began on August 7, 2010, in Canada, and September 6, 2010, in the United States, and is currently still showing. Geisel's books and characters are also featured in Seuss Landing, one of many islands at the Islands of Adventure theme park in Orlando, Florida, in an attempt to match Geisel's visual style. There are reportedly no straight lines in Seuss Landing. The Hollywood Reporter has reported that Johnny Depp has agreed to produce and possibly star in a film based on Geisel's life. The film will be written by Keith Bunin, produced by Depp's Infinitum Nile Production Company alongside Illumination Entertainment, and distributed by Universal Pictures Music. Red Hot Chili Peppers' Yertle the Turtle, last track on the album Freaky Styly, 1985. REM, The Sidewinder Sleeps Tonight, from the album Automatic for the People, 1990. Marilyn Manson used to make pop art flyers mixing porn pictures, serial killers and other celebrities' faces, self-portrait caricatures and Dr. Seuss characters for the promotion of his early band Marilyn Manson. References. Carrot, about the author, Dr. Seuss, Seussville. Timeline retrieved February 15, 2012. Carrot, Deal, Joshua. Filmcans and Vinyl, The Life of Dr. Seuss. Sungaze.com retrieved September 19, 2012. Carrot, Cohen, 2004, p86. Carrot, Cohen, 2004, p83. Carrot, Morgan, 1995, p65. Carrot, Pease, 2010, pp 48-49. Carrot, Lambiac Comiclopedia, Dr. Seuss. Editorial Cartoons of Theodor Seuss Geisel P16 ISBN 1-56584-704-0. Richard H. 1999 Dr. Seuss Goes to War, The World War II Editorial Cartoons of Theodor Seuss Geisel New York City, The New Press P. Retrieved April 10, 2012. Carrot, Laura Ingalls Wilder Award, Past Winners, Association for Library Service to Children ALSC American Library Association ALA. ALA. Carrot Minier 1999, p. 184. A. B. Wood, Haley and Ron LaMoth Interview August 2004. Interview with filmmaker Ron LaMoth about the political Dr. Seuss Mass Humanities eNews Massachusetts Foundation for the Humanities archived from the original on September 16, 2007. Retrieved September 16, 2008. Carrot Cott, Jonathan 1984 The Good Dr. Seuss Pipers at the Gates of Dawn, The Wisdom of Children's Literature Reprint Ed New York City, Random House ISBN. Carrot Dr. Seuss